Is that working for you, Grant? Can you hear the music?
Love it, eh?
Awesome.
Yeah, I can hear too.
So whilst folks are just getting warmed up, I put some instructions in the chat just for those that have just joined us. I can just work through those points, and we'll probably get kicked off with the main event about 6:10. And that's when Mike will take the stage. I'm really a warmer pack, so I don't know any great jokes, but let's see what I can do. Let me talk about Birmingham. Maybe that's a good one.
Lost your audio. The last of Vanguard music.
Oh no! That's my Vanguard music. Oh well, I'll switch back in a second.
Come back, yeah.
Go on, tell us about Birmingham.
Yeah,
I'll tell you about Birmingham. Grant, are you able to admit people that are coming in? Because I can't see that option now.
Yeah, yep. That's fine, mate.
Awesome. Right, folks, there's some instructions in the chat for anyone that's just joined us. Feel free to work through those. I thought I'd share a few insightful facts about Birmingham, because this is a Birmingham meetup, after all. But it doesn't
feel like it. It
doesn't feel like it at
international
all.
International meetup. Yeah.
So, Birmingham, the city of the Peaky Blinders. So I'm a big Peaky Blinders fan. So we have the largest public library in Europe. Not that I go there much, but we have a shiny building. It's absolutely amazing. It's been open, I think, a few years now, and it's awesome. And I believe there was a bar at the very top at some point. I don't know if they still have that there. And we have almost 20 universities within 1 hour of Birmingham.
Yeah.
Kind of cool. Again, not that I visit too many of those. What else do we have? Oh, here we go. This is a good one. Grant, this is one for you. We're one of the youngest cities in Europe.
Ah. So
we have 40% of our population's under 25 years old.
Wow. So we feel right in, buddy.
Yeah. There we go. Oh, and then the curry. So the curry is the national dish of England, I guess. A lot of people say that. And we have something called the Balti. And the Balti is a curry served in a copper bowl. But if we translate the word Balti into Punjabi or some of the Indian dialects, it actually means bucket. So hence why we have a chicken in a bucket. So I think KFC got there before us on that one, but we decided to...
It's not a copper bucket, though.
Yeah, there we go. Awesome. So I'm just going to stop sharing my screen for a second. So there's some facts about Birmingham.
So what is Balti like? Is it a red curry, yellow curry?
And it can be anything, to be honest, Mike. Yeah, we have sort of lamb curry served in the copper dish. We have chicken, pretty much whatever takes your fancy.
So there's a drink that I know is served in a copper cup. It's called the Moscow Mule. Have you heard of this one?
Oh,
it might be popular in the States. So it's ginger ale, vodka. The story was that there was somebody with ginger and someone, a Russian with vodka, that met on some crossroads, and they invented this drink, which is probably totally false. But so they mix it together. Typically, it has a lime in there and ice. Quite refreshing in a summer day.
Oh, awesome!
So you know, you could have a Balti and a Moscow Mule, and you'd have copper all the way around.
Wow, that sounds so cool. I'm going to have to try that next time I visit the States, hopefully.
It may be popular across the country or across the world now, too. I don't know. Ah, cool. Never ordered one elsewhere.
Right, what I'm going to do, I'm going to actually share our map. Let's see where people are from. Let's have a look on here. So, let's see. Let's go to the left, first of all. We have... Let me just refresh as well, by the way, just in case. Things aren't showing up. I saw Mike's posted right in the middle of the States there, so let's have a quick look. So welcome everyone that's just joined. Feel free to follow through some of the actions that we've put on the chat. You've just joined us. I'm just getting... Oh, here we go. This is awesome. So we have a few people from the States. Oh my God, from the Bay Area. Amy, all the way on the left there.
Right, Marcia.
Wow. And there's Mike, right in the middle there. Who else do we have? Let's see. There's one that's testing my eyesight here. I can't actually see.
Yeah, that's quite small.
I think that's Anne from Texas. I was looking at that one earlier. Okay. Yeah, Martha over here and the blank one. I'm not sure who that one is. Right, let's have a look. Let's go a bit. Let's go south. Wow.
Brazil.
Hey, Andrea.
Andrea, awesome. Thank you for joining from Brazil.
Obrigado.
There we go.
Obrigada.
Super duper. Oh, wow. Look, we have somebody from Kenya.
All right. Kenya.
And we have more people from Africa. A few blank ones. I love this one here. Look, Ansi. Is that Ansi? I'm not sure. Argentinian living in Barcelona. Wow. Oh, here's some German contingent. And I do know Kroller. Kroller used to work with me at Deutsche Bank. And I love the efficiency of our German colleagues.
Correct.
Kroller, what's with the dark border around the post-it? Because all the German folks have done that.
I don't know.
Oh, okay.
It wasn't expected.
Trendsetters.
Awesome. Maybe that's the default setting for the German browser.
That can be the case, yes.
Got some from Warsaw.
We have, is it Bunasera? Bunasera, yeah, Romania. Awesome.
Sounds almost Italian to me.
Not yeah.
Far away, huh?
Yeah, there we go. And then we have some Italian folks. Oh, look at the UK contingent.
John from Leeds.
Lots in there. I know a few of these names. Indy. Claire. Indy's.
Got a Leeds boy in there. Good.
Oh, yeah. Hanji from Indy. Bradford.
Yeah.
Awesome. Oh, there's a nice elephant there. I saw somebody with a
picture
of an elephant. I could do this all day. This is awesome. We have Sandra from Stockholm.
Have you been to Australia yet? Do we have somebody in Australia?
Oh, yeah, yeah. Let's go to Australia.
Yep, I'm from Australia.
There you go.
And it's the middle of the night.
Oh, that's dedication, Bromley. Well done.
Wow.
What time are we on there?
It's 1 o'clock in the morning.
Oh, my goodness. Dedicated. Oh. You get some kind of special gift for that one. I don't know, like a cup of coffee through the chat.
Wow, that is dedication. Thank you so much, Bronwyn, for joining. Okay, folks, I think we're going to kick off in a second. So let's do that in a second. So first of all, I just want to welcome everyone, and I'll just turn the music down for a second. I just want to welcome everyone to the Visual Jam Meetup. So Grant and I, and I'll let Grant give a quick intro in a second. Grant and I are really excited to be launching this meetup. We've been talking about it for months and months, and we're super excited today that we finally got there, and we have an awesome guest as well. And it's so amazing to see so many people from so many corners of the world. If somebody had said to me 6 months ago, we're going to have people from Australia and all of these different awesome places at our first meetup, I would have thought they were being absolutely crazy. So that is so cool. So I'm Pardeep, but everyone calls me Paddy. My mother's the only one that calls me Paddy, but that's usually when I'm in trouble. So feel free to call me Paddy. I do like a good whiskey. So I think, you know, that's where my link to the Irish there in some way or other. And I do love music as well. But I would say, you know, my background, I'm from Birmingham. I was very artistic when I was a kid, and then pretty much left my artistic skills behind for many, many years because it just didn't pay the bills for me. And my parents were constantly pushing me towards a more traditional career. But it's so amazing to see how creativity is really taking over the world now. And so I've refound that. I'm an agile coach and a trainer by trade. So I'm going to pass over to Grant, who's going to introduce himself and introduce our super awesome guest. And in the meantime, I'm going to stop sharing, and I'll set Mike up so that he's ready. Over to you, Grant.
Cool. Thanks, Paddy. My story is quite similar in a way to yours, Paddy. I drew a lot when I was a kid. I used to love it. I studied it to A level and toyed with going to university and doing something, and then went in a completely different direction and did maths and business studies. I don't know why I did that, but I did. And since then, I've kind of worked in business analysis and business architecture, and then that's kind of grown into agile delivery, transformation, And I guess in the last couple of years, I've really started to kind of get into visual thinking in a big way. I think I picked up our guest's book a few years ago, and I was interested in it, and I kind of toyed with it and played with it a little bit. But yeah, it's probably the last 2 years I've kind of picked up the passion again in anger. And I think what I've noticed is people are now interested in what I do for a living, and they never were before. My kids, I've got four girls, and they can be less interested in what I do for a living. And now they're interested, they want to join in and draw some pictures. And yeah, I just find it brings a fun dimension to what I do, my work, and it makes it more interesting and stands out. So I'm just really excited to kind of get this meetup going, to learn more, to grow a community. And yeah, that's kind of my story. And I guess we wanted to start the visual jam with a bit of a bang. And so we thought, who's the big name that we could try and go after that could get that is all about visual thinking and sketchnoting? So we reached out to Mike, and we're really pleased, Mike, that you agreed to join us. So I won't embarrass you anymore by kind of trying to give you the intro. I'll let you say hello and explain to the guys what we're going to focus on today.
Great. Well, welcome everyone. Thanks for coming. I'm going to switch in just a moment over to my desk cam so you can see what I'm going to draw. That's where all the action will be. So you probably don't need to look at my picture. So I'll switch over now. What we're going to do is we're going to try something. I like experimenting and trying things. And so we're going to do that today. We're going to do something I've not really done before, especially in camera, and that is to deconstruct the sketchnote. We're going to take a sketchnote that I've used a lot, so I'm pretty familiar with it, and that's the Steve Jobs commencement address at Stanford, which you can view the text of if you like. And the thought when Paddy and Grant and I had talked about it was, it would be really interesting if we could like almost put slow motion on doing sketchnoting, so you could start seeing what I'm doing, and I can talk about my decisions as I'm making them, why I'm making those decisions. And we could sort of, we talked about it being almost a meta sketchnote. So I'll be doing a sketchnote, and then I'll be sketchnoting around the sketchnote to tell you what the sketchnote was. So that sort of makes your mind bend, that then you're welcome to the club. but we thought it would be kind of fun. I kind of like doing new things. This seemed like a fun new thing to do and a different way to look at things. And because we know that there's always a few people who come in who maybe don't have lots of experience with sketchnoting or visual thinking or feel not confident in drawing, I just find it's always a good level set to provide basic drawing skills to people that are here with us, just to be fair to them. And it's also, I just love the feeling of people having skills built when they can go for an hour and they come out with some skills that they didn't have when they started. That's always really satisfying to me. So that's what we're gonna do today. So I'm gonna switch over to my camera on the desk, and I'll make sure, I think it looks like Patty's already made me pinned. So I think my focus is there. So what I'm gonna do is, the first thing I'm gonna talk about is the basics. And I call these the five elements of drawing. I'll write them out for you. And you can follow along with me. Hopefully you've got some paper and pen. I think this is a great opportunity to come in and do some drawing with us and take notes. So what I discovered was when I had the book to write, if I didn't teach people how they could draw basics in a basic way, I wouldn't sell many books. So I had to find a way to explain this concept. And what I realized when I looked at the work that I did was that I actually did lots of really basic stuff if I really broke it down. And that was five basic elements of drawing. And I sort of look at it as almost like working with Legos. That's the way I like to describe it. So instead of thinking about drawing as you would in the traditional sense, especially if you took university, where you draw still lifes and you draw people and you know, you're trying to observe and draw, this is more along the lines of drawing what's in your head, or taking the ideas that are in your head and making them into something very simple. And the reason I say it's like Legos is because there's five parts. So there's a square. And the cool thing is none of these have to be Perfect. So there's square, the circle, the triangle, the line, and the dot. I'll write those under there for you. So there's a variety of these types of elements out there. Lots of my friends in the visual thinking space have their collection. They have more than mine, or maybe, you know, I don't know that anyone has less than mine, but I just felt like if I could boil it down to about five, that sort of fits the Dunbar, which is a 5 ± 2. It felt rememberable to me. If you could break it down to five elements, that would be pretty rememberable, even for little kids, right? So that's what I did. What I realized was if I boiled it down to these five shapes, I could use them to build different things. So as an example, to start on this side, well, a house is really a square with a triangle on top of it. And it honestly doesn't have to be a very good triangle or square. It can be misproportioned, and yet we still perceive it, right? It's even better when you put the word next to it. And that's the whole premise of Sketchnotes, this idea of mixing words and images together to make sense of things. So the kind of cool thing is you could stop here and you've got maybe an icon on your phone or something, but you could certainly add more detail. So just using these same elements, I've got a rectangle, which is a form of square. I could use a line to make a window on the door. Then if you can see this little dot, that's my doorknob. And then up in the attic here, let's put a window. Maybe it's got some panes on it. And then on top, you've got the chimney. So here we've basically used most of the pieces. We've of course used the square, we've used the triangle, we've used the line, we've used the dot. And then I can do another line here if I want to do smoke coming out. Really the only thing I haven't done is the circle. So I mean, I could, if I wanted to, I could even draw a line here and say, you know, the sun's coming up. Now I've got the circle, there's all five elements and a really simple drawing. And what I think this does after teaching this a lot is it sort of democratizes drawing and makes it simpler for people to approach and not feel like they have to be an amazing artist. And that comes back to my phrase, which I say all the time, it's even on my water can, and that is ideas, not art. This idea that we're drawing ideas. The art quality is less important than getting the ideas right and being able to capture the ideas. So that's what that's all about. So what we're gonna do is, I invite you to follow me when we do sketchnoting today and as I do this talk, to do these five elements. And to get us ready for the talk, since we know we're gonna do Steve Jobs, I'm actually gonna go through and do some icons with you. So the first one I'm gonna draw is Steve Jobs himself. So let's put his name up here. I'll just write Steve since we know it's Steve Jobs. So to keep it simple, I would start with just an oval for his head. Doesn't have to be perfect. Right, there we have a start. I would put a couple of ovals here right away for his ears, just about the midpoint of where the head is. And then come in and do circles for his glasses, because in this talk he wears glasses. They're kind of round. And then I just connect them with a line. And then some dots inside, just for the eyes, really simple. Now, Steve has pretty bushy eyebrows, so you can put a little bit of, starting to look like he could be Groucho Marx in some ways. And then a little line here for his nose. And then his signature is, at this point in his life, he had a goatee. So just do some scribbles around here to form a goatee and maybe a mouth. And he has a little bit of hair on top, so you can, you know, do some stubble up like this. And what I like to do in this case, because I know that he is doing a commencement address, I do two lines for his neck and a half circle for, you know, the shirt that he's got on. But then, after doing the lines for his shoulders, I actually do the bottom part of a triangle. And what this is the, I don't know, there's a name for this thing that you wear that's when you're at a commencement, right? This thing, there's probably a name for it that I can't think of. So there's a really basic drawing of Steve, and we'll use that when we do the sketch note. So there's another icon. He talks a little bit in this talk about dropping in and out. And so I thought it would be fun to do this as well and show you. So I think of dropping out as almost like drawing a cloud. So using that circular shape to create the cloud, and then you have an arrow coming down out of it. Really simple, basically a triangle and two lines to connect. And then, so that's dropping out. And then dropping in would be the inverse. You use the same thing. So you could even write out an in if you wanted to further reinforce that, right? I'll connect this. Something else that he talks a lot about is because he's had such heavy influence on the creation of the Mac, I thought it would be helpful to show you how to draw a really simple old school Mac, classic Mac. So I start with a rectangle like so. Those old classic Macs had a really tiny screen. It's kind of amazing to think people did magazines and stuff. And then a really prominent part of it is the floppy. And I'm actually going to put a little circle in the middle because there's a point where you could grab the floppy out. I wouldn't give any more detail than this other than to say there's two ways you could do it. In our case, he talks about typography. So I'm going to put a little F in there to represent typography. So the other thing about the Mac that I always want to include is you have to have ways to operate it. So I'll just do a little rectangle for the keyboard. And what I like to do when I do a keyboard is I'll do the lines horizontally first, and then I'll mark off where my space bar is. And then I can just do the keys around it. It's just a really quick hack for showing, making sure you account for the space bar. And then of course you need a cable coming into the keyboard and out of the keyboard. At the time, there was a mouse, right? So you've got a little Mac. Something else he talks about in the process of the talk is that success became heavy for him. So I had this idea when I looked through the text for heavy, was this idea of somebody like straining under the load. So what I'm gonna have you do is start with a rectangle for the body like this, and then a head. So we've got a rectangle with a head here. And then I want you to draw someone's arms like working hard to hold something up. And then we'll do one leg this way, so they're, you know, really straining. And then one leg back like this. And see how they're sort of, we can even put a line under there. There's somebody straining. And then I had this image of, what if we actually did like a cup, you know, you'd win in a sport contest or something, put an S on there for success. So you've got this cup of success and it's really heavy and this person is really weighed down. Another image that's he talks about is the opposite of heavy, we'll go on the next line, is lightness, the lightness of starting over. You'll hear this. And so I thought, what would represent this? And I thought of the movie Up, the Disney Pixar movie Up. So start with a rectangle and put a head on there in a circle. I just fill them in. Have their arm going up and their other arm like so. And then I almost do like clicking heels or something. And you'll see why in a minute. So we'll do some lines here and then circles for the balloons. So the idea is that he's so light that these balloons are helping him lift, and to pull off the suggestion, you actually put the line of the shadow underneath him with a little space, so he's actually floating. So it reinforces this idea of lightness, and we'll try and work this into the sketch note when we get to that point. He talks a little bit about having to take awful tasting medicine. So my image of medicine is like a bottle, like this. I think it's pretty standard, a label if I do RX. I think that's a pretty standard thing. I've seen that in Europe when I've been there. And then I think I would extend the line. You see how I use lines quite a bit to suggest a baseline? And then there would be a little cup here where you've got your medicine. In fact, if you wanted to, you could, you know, color this in to suggest there's still medicine in the bottle. Right, so that's always an option. So there's medicine. He talks a little bit about death. My first impression when I see death is just a tombstone. And I keep my tombstones really simple. I just do sort of a curved rectangle like this. And then I draw a line in front here. And what this does is suggest depth. And the last thing I'll do is to put a line here for the earth. And maybe you do RIP or something. That's a really simple way to show death. Rather than a sickle and somebody in a hooded cloak or something. Maybe you could even, you know, if you wanted to go further, if you had time, you could do, you know, daisies, pushing up daisies or something. And then the last one, and this is a little bit of a stretch, but I thought I would try it anyway. And it was, he talks about dogma. And he talks about dogma in the idea that dogma can be this heavy thing that people press on you. And so for whatever reason, I thought it would be interesting to draw a suit. And so what I would do is start with a rectangle like this. And rather than complete the rectangle, just do two lines like so. And then extend down and finish the rectangle. And you'll see where I'm going in a minute. So I'm going to take another line here and connect these. I'll do a line across here to connect those. And then I'll do a line here to make the pants. So you can start to see it's like a suit of clothes. And what I want to do is maybe this could be on a hanger. And then the person here, I've got their hand out, have their arm extended. Draw a line in the arm, will fill in their body. Sort of, you see, I'm following this pattern for people where they're just a rectangle and circle for a body and a head. And then they're sort of standing their ground with their legs out. Idea being here that you're not going to accept someone else's dogma. So it's a little bit of a stretch conceptually, but provides an interesting way to think of it. So those are some basics. Now I may be moving fast, so I'll leave that up for a minute while I get myself ready. And then we're going to go ahead and do some sketchnoting. So a couple things that I'm gonna do that are different today is I'm gonna do a sketchnote in my notebook. And I've got two things. I've got audio of the sketch, of the talk we're gonna go through. And then I printed out like the whole text. So if you go to Stanford, they actually have the whole text of the whole talk that you can use. So when Grant and Paddy and I talked about this, we had this idea that one thing that could be useful from a business perspective is you get so many reports and information coming in all the time that you need to make sense of. A lot of what we hear are, of course, video, but a lot of times you have a report or a PowerPoint or something, and maybe you just need to simplify it and make some sense out of it. So why not, let's show what it would be like if I were to go through this, if I had the script as well as the video, and then deconstruct it and show you how I think about it. So I'm gonna actually move over here because I'm gonna start on this left page. I'm gonna get my black pen. This is a 1.0, it's a new one called a Sharpie gel, which I don't know if they're available in outside the US yet or not, but I tend to like working in a bold black and then I add detail afterwards. So what I'm gonna do now is we know, if we bring back our little card here, I know that this is gonna be Steve Jobs, right? So one thing I can do is I always start, if I know who it is ahead of time, I just go ahead and I draw their picture. I might look up their picture online. So my trick is anything you can do before you get to the event, whether it's you sitting down and processing information, anything you can do when you're not under pressure can be useful to do ahead of the event. So this is probably more applicable to an event that you're going to, that you know, you're expected to do some work or you want to do something and you want to share it. But anything you can do ahead is going to help you because it's not going to be pressure on you to do it later. You're sort of getting it, you're sort of doing something nice for your future self, I guess, maybe is a way to look at it. So there's old Steve. So the couple of things I know is this is Steve Jobs, so I can do his name. I'll use my two-line method. You can sort of see what I do. I do a single line and I add a second line afterwards and fill it in. It's a really quick way to do lettering. You'll notice I do some tucking. So see how the E is sort of tucked under here? Sometimes I'll do that. A little bit lower. That's old Steve Jobs. So I'll finish out my lettering. The last thing I'll put is the commencement address in Stanford. And you can do as much detail or as little detail as you want for this, really. It's sort of up to you. So I think I've decided I want to use this space for something. I don't know what it is yet. So I'm actually going to move up here to this space here and do Stanford commencement address. And I think I'll do a little smaller typography. Maybe I'm kind of feeling script here. I don't know, that might be a mistake, but let's try it. Unfortunately, commencement is quite a long word. I wonder, and then I think like, could I get away with just commencement? Maybe I can leave that. I'll leave some space here. So those are some of the thoughts that I have. So now I've, so one thing I want to make a comment about this little card. This can be actually a useful tool. If you know there's some icons, if you're going into a talk where you know it's going to happen, having a little card reference like this that you prepare ahead of time, again, you're helping your future self, is to make these little cards with icons or little notes, anything that will help you in the moment. And it can be separate from the sketch note, right? So you can leave it up here while you're working and then you can refer to things. So why don't we, let's do that. I'm gonna just leave that a little bit off camera and we'll do that. So now what I'm gonna do is I've prepared the heading. What I'm gonna do now is I'm gonna start the audio and I will show the text while the audio is playing. So you can see that, so here we go. So you can see this is almost like the way I would work if I was working from a recorded video or some kind of text or something. So it gives you a sense of how maybe you can apply this in a business or other setting. So here we go with the audio. And what I'm gonna be doing is playing a little bit, stopping, doing some sketchnoting and playing again. So it's gonna be sort of a stop and go affair to sort of give you a sense of what's happening. So here we go. If I can get my...
Honored to be with you today for your commencement from one of the finest universities in the world.
It's right here.
Truth be told, I never graduated from college, and this is the closest I've ever gotten to a college graduation. Today, I want to tell you three stories from my life. That's it. No big deal. Just three stories.
Okay, I'm going to stop there. So notice that he repeated something twice. He said three twice. So that's a real good indicator that he's got an outline that he's working from. So I'm gonna raise a big red flag. I don't know if I have a red marker here. Maybe I'll do a big highlighted flag. So this is your warning. some people will say they have 3 points, but they really have 4 points and they'll sneak it up on you like an assassin and they'll hit you with it and you're not going to expect it. And you're gonna have laid out your page beautifully. You're gonna have a heading and you're gonna have three sections, 1, 2, 3, and then they're gonna throw number 4 in on you. And then you're gonna be stuck. So this is just a warning to not always believe what people say. Now, this is a recording, so we know that he's only got 3 stories, right? That's sort of the beauty of this. And I think he's also very tight and he did not allow himself to get distracted. But this is just a warning to remember that even though people say they only have X number of points, be ready for them to throw something at you, right? So, all right, so let's start again. I'm gonna show part of story one, and I'll flip through the pages as we go. So what we'll do is we'll listen to story one, and I'll pause and do some drawing after. We'll sort of take it piece by piece.
The first story is about connecting the dots. I dropped out of Reed College after the first 6 months, but then stayed around as a drop-in for another 18 months or so before I really quit. So why'd I drop out? It started before I was born. My biological mother was a young, unwed graduate student, and she decided to put me up for adoption. She felt very strongly that I should be adopted by college graduates, so everything was all set for me to be adopted at birth by a lawyer and his wife. Except that when I popped out, they decided at the last minute that they really wanted a girl. So my parents, who were on a waiting list, got a call in the middle of the night asking, "We've got an unexpected baby boy. Do you want him?" They said, "Of course." My biological mother found out later that my mother had never graduated from college and that my father had never graduated from high school. She refused to sign the final adoption papers. She only relented a few months later when my parents promised that I would go to college. This was the start in my life. And 17 years later, I did go to college, but I naively chose a college that was almost as expensive as Stanford. And all of my working class.
Okay, I want to stop for a second. You see that I'm highlighting through this. I'm just basically doing what I would do in sketchnoting. I'm identifying patterns that I'm seeing. So you see this college pattern that's going on. He's speaking to college students that are graduating from a college. He's not a graduate. And he's reinforcing how important it was as a adopted kid for his birth mother that he go to college, right? So he's laying out this structure. And then even, I love this little joke. It sort of sneaks by and probably the Stanford people pick it up. Almost as expensive as Stanford. So he's like making a joke at how expensive Stanford is, right? And he feels bad that he's using all his college, his parents' savings to go to this outrageously expensive college. All right, so I'm gonna keep going.
As parents' savings were being spent on my college tuition. After 6 months, I couldn't see the value in it. I had no idea what I wanted to do with my life and no idea how college was going to help me figure it out. And here I was spending all the money my parents had saved their entire life. So I decided to drop out and trust that it would all work out okay. It was pretty scary at the time, but looking back, it was one of the best decisions I ever made. The minute I dropped out, I could stop taking the required classes that didn't interest me and begin dropping in on the ones that looked far more interesting.
All right, I'm gonna stop and I'm gonna do some drawing now. So I'm gonna switch over. You see I'm highlighting as I go. So I'm just identifying things that are really interesting. But that highlighter really works well, doesn't it? So let's go back and so I don't think I need this anymore. I can sort of identify, okay, I'm gonna use drop out and drop in. Those are things in the theme. So let's move that off screen for right now. Now what I'm gonna do is, you don't really need to see the text, but you can see what I was kind of doing. And I think what I do is when I sketchnote, I'm actually doing that same highlighting, I'm just doing it mentally. And I don't wanna go too far because I don't wanna get too far into the structure. All right, so there's this really important thing about a college graduate. Now, I didn't talk about this icon, but what I think I'm gonna do is, because I know he's got three things, I'm going to, right here, do a square. This is gonna be my style, and do the number one. And he even says, this first story is about connecting the dots. Now, I have the luxury of having both a video and a text. Right, so I can go in here and make choices. So I can say, I'm gonna give it a title, Connecting the Dots. I think I'll put a little, because I've got script running through this, I'm gonna add a little script for the dots. If you want to follow on and do something like this too, you can. So you see now something else, I've got a little bit of white space to play with. I tried to leave a little space here in case I want to add more detail or I want to add a note, or it gives me space to come back up and add some things. Connecting dots for me was, he's starting, and even though he's not finished his thought, the first thought is there's a important thing for college. So I think maybe the first image I want to draw is like a baby, but a baby with like a, I think there's a name for this too, which I can't think of. You know, the hat you wear when you're, there's little baby Steve. And I'll just do, you know, a really simple body. It's got a diaper on. It's probably a terrible baby, but that's okay. So he's got like no hands apparently. So what I say is like, one thing I'll tell you is sometimes you feel like things go wrong, just try and work with them. So here I added hands to him. Maybe I put little booties on him, right? So so it's important important that the baby go to college, right? The mother talks about this, right? So we got that down. And then he talks a little bit about spending, all of his parents' money on Reed College, right? So, but maybe what we first do is we show that there's this real importance for the mother. And maybe the way we can do this is, maybe the mother's hand is like, you know, handing off the page, handing the baby, right? So there we have connecting the dots. Let's say, maybe because we're not doing like a live sketch note, we're doing more of a constructed one. Let's say, what is the message that I'm hearing is that Steve's birth mother prized, I would almost say prized, a college education. So much. That she nearly stopped the adoption of Steve. So there's even some stuff you could unpack in here, like why did the five whys? Why did the mother? Why was it so important? She was apparently educated, and she. Maybe she saw what the life of a kid would be if they didn't have education, and she wanted to make sure, you know, maybe she felt bad that she had to give her son up for adoption, and there was all this stuff going on, right? So there's some things happening here around her thoughts, and I'm going to put a little note here. I'm going to say identify themes given by the speaker. So he's the one that said, if I go back to the text, he's the one saying the first story is about connecting the dots, right? So I'm just listening to what he's telling me. So they're gonna give you clues about what you wanna do. All right, so I think we've captured something about the importance of this. And then I'm going to come in and say, let's do young Steve in college. And I'm going to put this in quotations. I'm spending all my parents' money. Actually, it's my parents' savings. So the interesting thing that I think about as I'm writing this out, like, I guess I do this, I'm thinking, why is he so concerned about spending his parents' savings? Well, of course, he's a good kid. He doesn't want to bankrupt his parents for something he doesn't see valuable. But the other thing that comes to mind is like the mother's best intentions was that her son go to college. But when it comes to him actually fulfilling it, he's finding out that, a couple things, right? Did he choose the right place? So you could actually, I think the thing I like about Sketchnotes too is I can start putting in my own questions. Did Steve choose rightly? Maybe he should have gone to a state college, right? Spend less money. Or was Steve just not cut out for college? These are some of the things you can do if you're doing a talk where it's all coming at you live and you don't have this luxury. I would call it a luxury to sit here and deconstruct, like, what is Steve saying here, right? He's got this burden, right? He's feeling like, I don't see value. I think he made a comment about that. This is the kind of benefit you have if you're working with a document where you could sort of deconstruct it. It's almost like if you were in school where they made you diagram sentences and identify verbs and nouns and all that kind of stuff. It's kind of like, it's a little bit like that, actually. Okay. So I'm going to move this off the screen. Get my iPad going again. I know we're coming close here. I don't know if we're going to be able to get through Paddy and Grant, but
maybe I can. It wasn't all romantic. I didn't have a dorm room, so I slept on the floor in friends' rooms. I returned Coke bottles for the 5-cent deposits to buy food with. And I would walk the 7 miles across town every Sunday night to get one good meal a week at the Hare Krishna temple. I loved it. And much of what I stumbled into by following my curiosity and intuition turned out to be priceless later on. Let me give you one example.
Okay, I'm going to stop for just a second again. I guess we're really getting into the detail here. So notice what he's saying. Like, he's got this contrast going. On the one hand, he feels required by his parents and his birth mother to go to college. And they fulfill their part of it. When he actually gets there, he finds out he's not cut out for it, or it doesn't feel like value, and he drops out, right? And he drops into the interesting things. He even tells you that it wasn't romantic, right? He slept on people's floors. He had to return bottles for deposits. He had one good meal a week, but he loved it, right? Like, so there's something there. And then he comes in, you know, he's got this value language going on. He talks about, he stumbled into this by dropping out, and he found it priceless later on. So he's really like, he's reinforcing, remember the title is Connecting the Dots. And you'll see later when he sort of hits you with sort of the punch for this point, that he actually sort of makes the connection why this is important. So now let's go back into the next part.
Reed College at that time offered perhaps the best calligraphy instruction in the country. Throughout the campus, every poster, every label on every drawer was beautifully hand calligraphed. Because I had dropped out and didn't have to take the normal classes, I decided to take a calligraphy class to learn how to do this. I learned about serif and sans serif typefaces, about varying the amount of space between different letter combinations, about what makes great typography great. It was beautiful, historical, artistically subtle in a way that science can't capture, and I found it fascinating. None of this had even a hope of any practical application in my life. But 10 years later, when we were designing the first Macintosh computer, it all came back to me, and we designed it all into the Mac. It was the first computer with beautiful typography. If I had never dropped in on that single course in college, the Mac would have never had multiple typefaces or proportionally spaced fonts. And since Windows just copied the Mac, it's likely that no personal computer would have them.
Nice joke there, Steve.
If I had never dropped out, I would have never dropped in on that calligraphy class, and personal computers might not have the wonderful typography that they do. Of course, it was impossible to connect the dots looking forward when I was in college, but it was very, very clear looking backwards 10 years later.
All right, so I think that's the punch, right? Because let's go to the next one. I'm gonna play a little bit more, sorry.
Again, you can't connect the dots looking forward. You can only connect them looking backwards. So you have to trust that the dots will somehow connect in your future. You have to trust in something, your gut, destiny, life, karma, whatever. Because believing that the dots will connect down the road will give you the confidence to follow your heart, even when it leads you off the well-worn path. And that will make all the difference.
Looks like my text is a little different than the video. So, all right, so he's starting to get into it now, right? So he talks about how he loves it. He talks a little bit about typography. So this is where I would start bringing in, so I've got an image here. I think I would sort of think about the layout. I might, on point two, I would do the Mac. Remember that Mac icon we did? A rectangle, a smaller sort of a square in here. A line with like a circle where you grab your floppy. Maybe for this one, I'll turn the keyboard just to be radical. Remember we do the horizontal lines first. I mark out where my space bar is, and then I can do the rest of the keys. Just a really quick way to do it. I might even, so if you want to add depth, just do lines straight down, because those little keyboards are really thick, right? And maybe I put the cable coming with the keyboard is here, and maybe there's sort of like, it reinforces this idea of connecting the dots, right? This connection going on. And then of course, typography. All right, so let's come back to the text here. So what he's realizing is that he took this course about calligraphy, and that gave him the freedom to actually learn, which is really interesting, right? like the forced learning actually made him not want to learn. And when he got to choose what he wanted to learn, like there was no pressure, suddenly he was doing what he was interested in learning. That so much that he found it fascinating, right? He's making these connections. And he even recognizes that when he took it, he didn't have any practical application. Like, what are you gonna do with calligraphy in a professional setting? But 10 years later, like this is, he's starting to build up to this looking back, right? He's laying out all the structure that 10 years later, he made the first computer with typography. He reinforces dropped in, drop out, dropped in. So this recurring theme. He even got a joke in there for Windows copying the Mac, which is kind of fun. He snuck that in there. And then he reinforces, this is really interesting. It's pretty interesting when you see the text like this. So he talks about, it's impossible to connect the dots looking forward. I've actually got the wrong text here. He reinforces this twice too. You can't connect the dots. So here's, you know, one and two. And then here's backward and backward. So he's got these repeating patterns. This is sort of his style. And then, I mean, that he's sort of telling you that it worked for him, and he's sort of saying, you got to trust this, and that it hasn't let him down. So he's basically asking you to trust him that this actually works, right? So maybe what we could do is, so he talks about this. He doesn't see the value. Here we've got our Mac, and I'm going to say, I'm using script here, so I'm going to say calligraphy. Maybe I would come in and just, would be my faux calligraphy where I put a little bold on one side of the letter form. And then I was just thinking, like, why couldn't I, I've got this Y here, I could point how it's connecting, right? So you've got calligraphy going into the Mac. You might not even have to say this is a Mac. Maybe it's enough to show this, right? And then maybe the message here is, what's this G? No practical value. And then this is 10 years later. What could be interesting is actually if he's, we know he's talking about connecting the dots. We know a little bit because we've jumped ahead. So now you've got calligraphy goes into the Mac. Maybe this actually comes to this. This comes like this. So you're sort of going through there and now it's coming back to no practical value. Like looking back, it actually, Macintosh, let's do. I sort of got myself into a pickle over here, but that's okay. So this is starting to talk about this. Maybe the way I would wrap this up is say impossible. I love the word impossible here. I'll just use simple lettering. He said, impossible to connect dots. Looking forward. And then maybe the response to this is, I'll go back into script again. Trust that they connect. Looking, I'll emphasize. It might be fun actually, I guess I'm off the page here. It might be fun actually writing the word backward, which would take a little time, but let's just stretch it out. Maybe I'll use the same pattern that I'm doing here. So I'll do the arrow like this. And the other thing I might do is, I really feel like this is important, I might emphasize it with a symbol, like right here, I might use a star. So, I'll bring it up a little bit, you can see the whole thing, right? So here we've got the first, and we're coming up right on our time. And look at this, I've only gone through one. So you see I'm like seriously diving into this. Let's put a few notes in here while I'm here. So what I'm gonna say here is see the looking back pattern and echo it. And then here we're reinforcing. Because he knew, so he wrote the script, right? He's laying all this stuff out for you. Like he tells you connecting the dots, but he doesn't tell you what he means. He starts laying out this argument. When he gets to the end, you realize that actually it's all about looking back. The only way to know is to look back. I'm gonna put a note here. Let's emphasize. After, this is after. Here I'm gonna put a note to use the medium. So in other words, he's talking about calligraphy. In this case, it just worked out. I'm using the medium to reinforce. A little note here would be, we planned ahead. Right, because we did this icon before we started. Now, we have the advantage again of having all these resources before we begin. But if you, there are some things that you can prepare for that you could guess, right? Let me put a note here, because I haven't finished it yet, would be white space. Okay, as is. But useful if needed. And I would say the same thing for this space here, because remember, I drew the baby first and I came in and put the hand in. So you can see that the hand became a useful device to show the mother giving way, Steve, little Steve. It'd be a funny little joke now that I come back in is like, what if little Steve had little glasses and a goatee, right? So you can start to make the connections. So that's a kind of weird stuff the brain does when I'm doing this kind of stuff. One last note that I'll put is summarize. A lot of what you're doing when you're doing sketchnoting is doing summarization, which comes from analysis. So you're analyzing what's being said and you're summarizing. Because you, I mean, look at how much text we've gone through. How many pages is this? We haven't even gone through almost 4 pages of text. Now, of course, it's big. But all that text, 3.5 pages, got boiled down to 1 page, right? So part of the job that you're doing is compressing this information. And the idea being that you would be able to decompress it later. It's almost like you're making an espresso, right? So with an espresso, you can always make an Americano. You just add hot water. Right, but if you don't have the espresso in the first place, you don't have anything. So in a lot of ways, what we're sort of producing is this really condensed analysis of information. So Paddy and Grant, I apologize, we're at time and I've sort of blown through only like the first point. But I think you can, like, if you're listening, like you sort of get the message, right? You can see where I'm heading and what I'm trying to show you, right? In the way that I approach this stuff. Now, of course, I'm like really going nerdy and detailed and breaking things down, which is what the intention of this. But as you, the idea is that you do this slowly, and maybe this is actually a really good practice for getting better at it before you do it, before you share it with anyone, is watching videos. Maybe you print out, if you can get the manuscript and you can sort of deconstruct it like you would a sentence, you can start to sort of build these muscles slowly, privately, until you start feeling, and then maybe the next challenge is, okay, now I won't print out the script. Now I just have to watch the video and see what happens. Like, how do these activities that I do, I'm doing, how do they speed up and how do they work in a more pressured situation? So you sort of move yourself from this place where it's under control and you sort of put yourself out to where it's more out of control. And that's where it kind of gets fun, right? Where you can, you're sort of playing and exploring and trying things out. That's where you learn more about yourself. So I think I'm going to stop there. What I may do is continue this and finish the sketch note and share it with you guys after hours, just for fun, because it'd be something we could share with Visual Jam. I'll do the same process and I'll put my notes in there, and then we can share that with the Visual Jam guys. Are there any questions that you want to ask with a few minutes that we have? And I can go over a little bit.
Mike, on a personal level, I could spend hours asking questions for my own selfish benefit, but I'd just like to say that, I mean, no need to apologize for sharing that. I thought it was absolutely awesome. When we spoke last week and we kicked around, this is exactly what I was hoping for, where we can slow down the process, get into your thought process. The way you were doing the highlighting gave us an insight into how you listen, the keywords and the triggers. I personally noticed your combinations of fonts and lettering and how you don't have to draw everything. I fall into that trap all the time. I'm trying to think of an icon.
Yeah.
So having good lettering to fall back on, there's so many nuggets in there. I thought it was fantastic.
I've had many people say when they watch me, like, if you buy my books and you watch the videos, there's actually videos of me working in both of them. And people are remarking, like, why is he drawing so little? Like, they're really surprised that there's actually very little. Like, I'm doing way more listening and processing and sort of making decisions, which is the hardest thing to learn, because you feel like you want to do everything. But I mean, if I wanted everything, I would just watch the video, right? The point is, you want to hear my perspective of it or my condensation of it. That's the value that I can bring, is what am I seeing that maybe somebody else isn't seeing, or my unique angle, right? Yeah. Like, even I haven't broken down his talk in this level of detail. Like, when he talks about his birth mother, like, my wife was adopted, so there's all these dynamics that she's gone through. She's found her birth mother. So I can now, from the other side, see all the dynamics of, like, finding your birth mother and how important that is, and what could be the motivations behind someone requiring their kid going to college. And, like, there's so many questions you can't answer, but it makes you think a lot more about what he's saying. Like, if you just brush over the surface of what he's saying, it's one thing. But if you actually start deconstructing what people say, it's really fascinating. You can really go deep and probably form, I mean, if Steve is still alive and you had an opportunity to ask questions, you could probably have like 50, 100 questions for him just on this one 15-minute talk, which is amazing.
Yeah, so much to read into it. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I was going to say, Mike, actually, there was a question early on from Tracy, so I'll just kind of pick on that one. As I know there's been some great debate on the chat, but so Tracy was saying, you know, one thing that she often finds that she gets stuck on is she writes faster than she draws, I guess. So, you know, any tips for her there? So I think that's one thing that perhaps puts her off trying to sketchnote a talk or a session. What would you suggest there?
Like, for, I guess you saw that I sort of made selections, like, even the things that I drew, I did include. So if you remember, we did like this in and out, and I had this idea that I might use that. Like, I didn't know what I was going to use. So actually, we never used that. So I think sometimes it's about making decisions about what you sketch. I think it's a challenge. So I will tell you that because I came from a place of writing too much, that drawing was an addition for me. So the challenge that I face is when I'm under stress, I have a tendency to just write too much. And I know that about myself, and I sort of identify it. And I try to catch myself if I can, and then I'll come and say, okay, you're just doing lots of writing. Okay, this is sketch noting. You should be sketches in here too. And so I sort of pull myself back. And the other thing that I discovered too is, like, if you're new to it or if you're under pressure, I think it's always good to have almost like a default way that you take notes under pressure. So, like, basically admitting that if I'm in a pressure situation, like, don't expect me to deliver some beautiful sketch note that's illustrated and everything's spaced out and there's lots of white space and everything's spelled right. Like, that's a lot of pressure to put on yourself. So if you have a tendency to be more of a writer, maybe your solution is to only have, like, on this in this talk, maybe I'll pick three things that I'll draw and the rest is writing. And maybe I emphasize lettering. Maybe I make lettering bolder, and that's my object, right? When they start repeating themselves. And so the other thing that I'll do is I use the linear format, which is left page to right page, top left to bottom right, as my basis. Other people can use different ones like radial or something. But I sort of find like, what are my basics? And then I just, if I get in a situation where I feel like it's overwhelming, I just fall back on my basics. I always have sort of my go-to stuff. And I think that helps to reduce the pressure on you. So maybe by like limiting, like almost setting minimums, like I've heard for exercising, it's always good to set minimums instead of maximums. So I'm gonna go for a run today. Well, I have to run at least 5 minutes, right? You might get into it and you run 15, but at least you did five. And if it's a bad day, you know, five is an accomplishment. So maybe it's the same way with this, where I'm gonna draw three images. I don't know what they're gonna be, but they're gonna strike me, and I'm gonna open myself to what's coming in, and I'll just sketch the things that strike me, and I have to do three. Go, right? That sort of reduces the pressure of having to draw everything and can be a way to solve that problem. Does that make sense?
No, absolutely. Thanks so much, Mike. So Grant, I guess anything more from your side in terms of some of the comments and questions that you've seen on the chat?
I haven't been monitoring them, I'll be honest, Paddy.
Okay, no worries. I had one from Christina, actually. She said she's interested. Okay. Do you use sketchnoting just for yourself or only if the output will be shared with others? So what's the reasoning for using sketchnoting? And that'd be good to hear your thoughts on that.
I use it for everything, and it doesn't always maybe look like sketchnoting, but I use it to think. So it's been ingrained in me. Like I tell people, it sort of leaks out when I'm at work. When I was physically at work, if I was in a room with a whiteboard, I'd typically be drawing and doodling on it or a piece of paper. I have my notebook here somewhere. Every day, I've structured my notebook in a way that allows me to have room to sketch and write. So this is from yesterday. It was such a crazy day that I didn't actually do my to-do list, but on the right, you can see I was already imagining today, how am I gonna do this? I'm gonna have a camera hanging over the top and a book. And you can see it's really, really sketchy. And I don't even think I have much wording on there, but it provides a space for me to draw. I was working on a sketchnote project for somebody else. So you can see here, I was laying out like maybe how the page would look. So, I mean, I'm always sketching and doing stuff. Having the ability to, you do it in different places. Here's another one. I was doing a masterclass with this guy, Chris Voss, who does negotiation. So I was just watching the first intro class and sketching him just to kind of get into it. So I use it all different ways. Like I really didn't plan on ever sharing that with anybody. Not that I'm, you know, I just did it for me. I think it's important that you do it for yourself first. That's what I always teach. Because I think the problem is if you go into it thinking that it has to be shown or someone else might see it, it's sort of, it makes you freeze up a little bit. You're worried about spelling errors. Like, I don't even care about spelling errors anymore. I do my best. I have some tricks to help. But if I make an error, it just proves that I'm a human being, right? So doing it for yourself first, and maybe even like not intentionally sharing it. Like, I have a friend, Michael, who is religious, and when he goes to religious services, he takes sketch notes, but nobody sees those notes. It's in a private book that only he sees. It's just for him, and that's okay. I think it's good to have things. I think there's so much pressure today with social media to like keep up with the hamster wheel and share things that it's kind of actually refreshing to not share. It's sort of like your little rebelliousness, right? To resist the social media giants and not share things as sort of a thumb in the nose to them, right? So.
Awesome. No, thank you so much, Mike. I appreciate you've already kind of run over, and I know you're very busy. So I guess I just want to thank you from all of us, really. And if everybody comes off mute maybe for a second, and we could give Mike a round of applause. I think everybody should be able to unmute themselves. Awesome. So after three, if we could all give Mike a round of applause. So 3, 2, 1. Hey, awesome.
Thanks, guys. I hope you enjoyed this, and it was helpful and gave you some tips and ideas.
Absolutely, Mike. So thank you so much. And I know Grant will reiterate this at the end. And so for everyone else, please stay on. We do have a couple of more things we'd want to share with you guys and do a little bit of networking as well. So but at that point, Grant, I'm going to quickly hand over to you to say any last words to Mike, and then we'll continue.
Just thanks again, Mike. That was awesome. I think just so many nuggets in that little excerpt. Just thanks so much for giving us your time, and I'm sure everybody's appreciated it.
Really, you're good. So welcome. I would stay if I didn't have a boring meeting to attend now. So unfortunately, duty calls. So
no, thanks a lot, Mike. Much appreciated.
Thanks,
cheers,
Mike.
Guys. Enjoy the day. Enjoy the evening, and we'll talk to you again soon, I'm sure.
Awesome. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye, everyone. Thanks for being here.
Okay, so Grant, I'm going to pass over to you for the next section. So I'm just going to put you on the spotlight. There we go. So over to you.
Cool. Thank you. I've got so absorbed in listening to Mike that I forgot what's coming next. I know we're doing some kind of a visual retro. So what we, Paddy and I had a chat, and we wanted to, being as this was the first kind of visual jam, we wanted to kind of get you guys to give us some feedback about what you might want to do with the visual jam and what you might want to learn and where you might want to go. So we've created a mural board. Paddy, have you shared the link for that? Can you pop it in
the
chat?
I'm just posting on the chat now, Grant.
Perfect. So we've just created a visual canvas with six themes on there for you to kind of have a look at. So if you guys open up the canvas, you can familiarize yourself with the layout. And then I think the idea, Paddy, is to drop people into breakout rooms so we can kind of have a bit of a conversation and get some feedback from the guys. So the themes we've put up there, any skills or techniques that you'd like to learn around visual thinking. The game section is we want to try and bring some things from the likes of innovation games and game storming, or just warm-up icebreaker type games that you think might be useful for us to use and share with the group. If there are any particular guests, I can see one of our future guests is in this meeting, but I won't give away who. Any general feedback about what worked, what didn't, if there are any technical hitches you'd like to see us overcome, anything like that. Any topics where we're not sure about what the speaker is, but anything you'd like to talk about. This doesn't have to be visual thinking. You know, Paddy and I have talked about having discussions around storytelling and explanation and improv and all sorts of things that are in the spirit of making work more fun. And then any other general ideas, thoughts, stuff that doesn't fit to any of the categories you'd like to share with us. So I can see people are doing that already, which is fantastic. Paddy, do you want to see if you can create the breakout rooms and let the guys have a chat and do a bit of networking, get to know each other at the same time?
Yeah, awesome. Just looking at time. So we'll give you about 10 minutes to have that discussion and post some of the stuff on the mural board. And then hopefully we'll get you all back in. And then we'll just talk a little bit about how we can get you the recording from today, and also a couple of messages as well. I know a couple of people have asked if they can share some messages through the chat. If you're able to come back. Awesome.
We've got plenty of feedback, so that's really good.
Yeah, so we unfortunately won't be going through the feedback right now, but feel free in your spare time to have a look, and you can add to it as needed, and we will be looking through every single post-it note separately, so be rest assured of that. So I just had a couple of quick messages, so I'm just going to paste them on the chat. So it was really to answer a couple of questions people had, so I'm just pasting a few points into the chat. So we're planning to make the recording available from today and all the future sessions. However, we also wanted to provide some extra resources as well. So Grant very kindly has done all of the icons for the retro. And if folks want to perhaps practice some of those icons, we'll be providing a kind of a mini guide that people can get hold of. So we've created a kind of a MailChimp page where you can subscribe to our newsletter. And we won't spam you with stuff, but it's really just so that we make sure we're able to get these links over to you in a from a single source. So there's a link in the chat for signing up to that newsletter. Tracy, who's also on the session, I've just pasted a message really for point number two. I think Mike had asked her to write a short article about iPad apps for sketchnoting. So if you'd like to know more on that, feel free to contact Tracy directly, and her email address is also in the chat. And so future events. So we do have events all the way up through to December planned. And I'll just put it up on the screen. And let's put a bit of music as well. I think it's always good to have a bit of music. So in true visual jam style, we'll put one of Bob Marley's tracks on just in the background whilst I talk through some of this stuff. So in terms of the next event, it will be, and hopefully you'll see my screen in a second. Can you see my screen yet, Grant? Have I not?
Yeah, I could. It's just disappeared.
Oh, yeah, let me put it back up. Super. So the next event is on 16th of September, and I can never say his surname right, so you might want to help me here, Grant. It's Dave.
Astronardi.
There you go. Don't say that after you've got a few whiskies. He's a CEO of Gamestorming Group. And if you're sort of interested, basically the Gamestorming Group, they've created the Gamestorming kind of playbook, which I put on this slide. So feel free to have a look at that. Really excited about that one. David's a really interesting character. I'm sure it's going to be another really interactive session. So we're going to be doing that. I think from my side, that was pretty much it. Oh, the other thing was, if you've created any sketches today, it'd be awesome if you could share them on social media. So you'll see on the screen, we've got a hashtag, the Visual Jam. So feel free to put those on Twitter and Instagram, whatever your social media platform is, or LinkedIn, etc. It'd be awesome if you could use that hashtag, just so we can keep an eye on that as well and help promote it. And feel free to tag us in using the symbol there, the Visual Jam. I would love to see your sketches and sketch notes. That was everything from me. Really do want to thank everyone for joining today. Grant, over to you for the final word.
I'd just like to thank everybody for coming along. It's been really good fun, and I think we learned a lot from Mike. I think it might be good to kind of share some thoughts or observations, again, either in social media or in the Meetup page itself. I've certainly got lots of things that I wanted to ask or discuss with Mike or with the group, and we just ran out of time. So let's continue the conversation after this session ends.
Yeah, maybe we can have a big thumbs up on the screen and I'll get a picture for everybody. So if you can just put your thumbs up at the screen, and we'll do a social media picture. So I'm going to put mine up. Just wait for a couple of other people. There we go. So just give me a second. I'm always rubbish with this thing. Hang on. Let me try it again. Ready? Okay. Awesome. I think I captured everyone. Oh, what a lovely, lovely snap that is. We'll share that as well on LinkedIn, etc. Awesome. Thank you so much, everyone. Take care of yourselves. Avoid the thunderstorms, because they're all coming in the UK right now. I can see them. And we'll see you on the 16th, hopefully. Thank you very much.
Cheers, guys.
Cheers, folks.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Thanks.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
See you, folks.
See you.
Thanks. Bye.